Welcome to Marlow Baptist Church. What a blessing it is for us to be together. If you are watching or if you are listening online, thank you for joining us. We look forward in August to be together as a church again. We'll continue to upload the services online to our YouTube channel. The audio will also still be available on our website. Please try and subscribe to our YouTube channel if you can, and also share the messages because that reaches out with God's Word. If you need more information, please go to our website. We will share all the information about the reopening of church, but it is such a blessing for us to look forward to the time when we can gather again together in God's house, worshiping the Lord and hearing His Word preached. May you be blessed today as we consider God's Word. We continue with our series on the book of Romans, and I trust that God will speak to your heart today. So may you be blessed and inspired. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, that we can come before you today. Thank you, Lord, for the blessing that we have, the blessing of salvation, the blessing of knowing you. Lord, we fall short, yet you have done all the work to reconcile us to yourself. We thank you for that. There is no other way that we could come before you or be reconciled with you unless you have done the work. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for your sacrifice, for your work that was done for us on the cross of Calvary. What a blessing that is to know. Thank you for the purpose that you've given to our lives. Lord, we are living in challenging times. We are moving toward a time now where we have some more freedoms, but yet it is still difficult for so many. Lord, our heart goes out to those who've lost loved ones, to those who are feeling anxious, those who have been housebound and feel sort of claustrophobia, Lord, and just feeling that we can't leave the house. For those who feel like that, Lord, we pray for them today. We know, Lord, that you are with us despite the circumstances we are facing. And thank you, Lord, for the blessing of knowing you. We commit ourselves to you, Lord, today. We pray for our church. We thank you, Lord, that as a church we'll be able to gather again in August. We also pray for those who watch and listen to the services, and we pray that all of us together, Lord, will be encouraged by your word today. Please be with us. We face many challenges as your people, but help us always to be mindful, Lord, of loving you and loving our neighbor. Help us to worship you. Help us to share the gospel with those that we can, that you give us the opportunity to do so. Help us to be faithful in our lives, that whatever we do and say, that we will honor you, Lord, in word and deed. Lord, we just want to live for you. You've started a work in us, and Holy Spirit, you continue that work by drawing us to righteousness. Help us to live for you, Lord. We pray for this world, we pray for the governments of this world, and we pray that there will be wisdom among the leaders in our world. So we pray for our government here in the UK, and we just pray that you'll give wisdom to our government. We know, Lord, that we have to respect the rules and the structures that have been put in place, and we do so as good citizens for your honor and glory. Help us to truly live for you in these times. We just commit ourselves, Lord, to you today. Speak to our hearts. May we hear your word, may we be doers of your word, and may we be blessed and inspired together, Lord, today, as we commit ourselves to you. In your wonderful name we pray, the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Our reading today will be taken by Vera.
Good morning, everyone. Today our reading is from Psalm 100, a psalm of thanksgiving. Make a joyful shout to the Lord, all you lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who has made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful to him and bless his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endures to all generations.
We have the blessing of listening to wonderful songs and hymns throughout our time online. And it's a blessing for us once again to listen to a song that is very meaningful, that links in with the message, but a song that I believe will truly bless our hearts today. We listen to the song, "He Will Hold Me Fast."
Christ our captain, for now the weak can say that they are strong in the strength that God has given, with sheer faith and built of truth, we'll stand against the devil's light, an army bold whose battle cry is love, reaching out to those in darkness. Our call to war, to love the captive soul, but to rage against the captor, and with the sword that makes the wounded whole, we will fight with faith and valor.
This is part 7 in our series, The Power of the Gospel. Today we are considering Romans chapter 7, and I've entitled the message, The Enemy Within. Our reading is taken from Romans chapter 7, reading from verse 14 to 25. For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, sold under sin. For what I am doing, I do not understand. For what I will to do, that I do not practice, but what I hate, that I do. If then I do what I will not to do, I agree with the law that it is good. But now it is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells in me. For I know that in me, that is in my flesh, nothing good dwells. For to will is present with me, but how to perform what is good I do not find. For the good that I will to do, I do not do, but the evil I will not to do, that I practice. Now if I do what I will not to do, it is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells in me. I find then a law, that evil is present with me, the one who wills to do good. For I delight in the law of God according to the inward man, but I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind, and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members. A wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then, with the mind I myself serve the law of God, but with the flesh, the law of sin. The strange case of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde was first published in 1886. The story is of a London lawyer who investigates strange occurrences between Dr. Henry Jekyll and the evil Edward Hyde. The novel's impact is such that it has become part of the English language. Someone who has a dual nature, outwardly good, but sometimes shockingly evil. That person has a Jekyll and Hyde nature. It is as if Robert Louis Stevenson read Romans chapter 7. What is it that makes people good at times, but also can make them so evil? Every single one of us has the potential for so much good, but also so much evil. Sometimes it depends on our environment, on circumstances, on pressures, and sometimes we surprise ourselves with how much evil we think about and the evil we feel and sometimes want to act out. It sometimes surprises us at the human potential for evil. And it's important for us to recognize that every single one of us, we are all sinners with that potential for evil. The devil is real, and we cannot deny his power and influence. But the Bible does not link the devil with our personal sin. Yes, he influences us. Yes, he tempts us. Yes, he wants to devour. But the greatest threat to our spiritual lives is not the devil, but it's us. We are responsible. We have a sinful nature. And we are responsible for our sin, and we must carry the consequences. So for us to blame the devil, for us to blame other people, is to justify our actions and not take personal responsibility. Because that is what Paul is doing in this passage. Paul recognizes the reality of the sinful, fallen nature that is still within him. So he has the potential for so much good in his godly nature, but also the potential for so much evil. So what is the reality of sin for us as Christians? On any biblical topic, there are always extremes. And when we deal with sin, there is one extreme view that is very dangerous. One of those errors is that there are Christians who believe that when you become a Christian, you now have the potential to live a sinless life, to attain some level of sinless perfection. And this is very dangerous. The belief that somehow in our Christian experience we can attain a level of holiness and sin can somehow be eradicated. This is not what the Bible teaches. In Christ, as Christians, our sins are forgiven. We are declared righteous. And we have become holy in Christ, but we are never without sin. Every single Christian still has sin within him or her. We still carry the first Adam with us, the reality of the physical flesh and the old nature. The only time that sin will ever be eradicated is that moment where we stand before the Lord Jesus Christ and we are in the presence of God in heaven. So how do we deal with sin in our lives as Christians? And not just lying and stealing and cheating, that type of sin that's happening in our world, or sometimes being rude or saying things we shouldn't be saying. But how do we deal with this propensity that we have to sin? And we don't always see it. People don't always recognize that real propensity, that real magnetic draw to sinful things. And we have to recognize it. So how do we deal with sin in our lives as Christians? I think the best way for us to explain this is through a Native American story. And it's a story of two wolves. And this story has been adapted by Billy Graham and also George Bernard Shaw. They both shared versions of this story. But I believe that this story resonates with everyone who hears it. And it's an old Native American story. And the story goes, an old Cherokee grandfather is telling his grandson a story. "A fight is going on inside me," he said. "It is a terrible fight between two wolves. One is evil. He is anger, envy, greed, arrogance, resentment, lies, and ego." He continued, "The other is good. He is joy, peace, love, hope, serenity, humility, kindness, empathy, generosity, truth, compassion, and faith. The wolves are fighting to death." Wide-eyed, the boy asked his grandfather, "Which wolf will win?" The old Cherokee simply replied, "The one you feed." Now, this might be a Native American story of wisdom, but it's true of the life of the Christian. The Bible says, "Walk in the Spirit and you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Flee fornication. Abstain from all appearances of evil." The question we have to ask, and that's what Paul is speaking about in this passage, is we have these two natures. We have this war within us between the old sinful us and the new godly us. Whichever nature we feed, that nature will win. The question we have to ask is, what are we feeding within ourselves? And what nature will win in our Christian lives? Will it be the old us feeding the flesh and living in sin? Or will it be the godly nature that we feed on godly things, on God's word, and spending that time with him? Where are we personally in this battle? Who is winning in this battle within us personally? As we look at the passage, I want to read from verse 14 to 19 as we consider the first part to this passage. And I've just entitled the first part, Our Struggle. So I'll read from verse 14 again to verse 19. "For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, sold under sin. For what I am doing, I do not understand. For what I will to do, that I do not practice. But what I hate, that I do. If then I do what I will not to do, I agree with the law that it is good. But now it is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells in me. For I know that in me, that is in my flesh, nothing good dwells. For to will is present with me, but how to perform what is good, I do not understand. For the good that I will to do, I do not do. But the evil I will not to do, that I practice." Can we identify with this struggle? And this struggle that Paul writes about and that God is inspiring him to write about. This struggle between wanting to do what is good, but sometimes doing that which is evil. Wanting to do what is good, but not finding ourselves always capable of doing it. I believe that most people want to do what is good, but yet we are drawn to doing what we shouldn't do. We are drawn to spiritual apathy as Christians. We are drawn to pride and ego. And we find ourselves doing and being things that are not actually godly. And this struggle is real for the Christian. And it's the struggle between the spirit and the flesh. And it's this constant struggle, the same as with that Native American story about these two wolves that are fighting. We see that there's this struggle within the Christian between the flesh and the spirit. Now, this struggle is not there for those who don't believe. This struggle is not real for unbelievers because they don't have the spirit. They only have the flesh. But for us as Christians, because God has done a work in our lives, our spirit has been made alive by God's spirit, this struggle is happening. So within the Christian, there are two natures. The old human fleshly nature, which the Bible calls the flesh. It is sinful and it is drawn to that which is not God's will and part of the world and the old us. And then we have this new nature, which the Bible calls the spirit, which is God-given, which God has done through giving us the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit then lives within us and makes our spirits alive so that we then are drawn to God. And this new nature is God-given and spiritual. So you have that of the flesh, that of the world, that of the old us, and then you have this new nature. See, as people, we are naturally drawn to sin. And we have to step back and truly understand that. That because we are born into Adam's race, we are drawn to sin. And it might not always be physical sin. It can be any sin. But naturally, we are separated from God and drawn into things that are not part of God's will. But in Christ, because God has done this amazing work within our lives through the cross of Christ and what he has done, in Christ now, there's this new us, this new life that has been created. And that new us is now not drawn to the world, but drawn to righteousness. And hence, we see the struggle. In Philippians chapter 2, verse 13, it says that it is God that works in us, both to will and to do of his good pleasure. So because this war is raging, it's a sign that something has happened. And it's God's Spirit, the Holy Spirit, and God's work in us that draws us to righteousness. He works in us to will and to be able to do of God's good pleasure. So this potential is in us the whole time for doing godly things, but also the potential for doing so many evil things. Now, both natures within us are born. Because we are born into the human race, we are born with a sinful nature. And that is for every single person born after Adam and Eve. We are born with a sinful nature. But we are also born with a spiritual nature in Christ. So we are born with a physical nature in Adam, but then God does this work within us when we are saved and we come to know Christ and confess him as Lord and Savior. And God then creates this new life in us and we are born spiritually. We are born again. So the Christian has these two natures within him. But how do we fight this fight? How do we actually win this battle over the flesh? How does the spirit dominate the flesh? How do we do that? But it's all about starving the old nature. And this is where the Christian life is a challenge for us in this world we're living in, because we're living in a world that constantly fuels the flesh, fuels desires, fuels lusts and greed and covetousness. Our responsibility as Christians is to feed the spiritual nature and to starve the flesh. If the flesh is fed and it becomes stronger and it becomes more powerful in our lives, sin will destroy us and control every part of our lives. So we need to feed the spirit so it becomes stronger than the flesh. What is this old nature? This old nature is the old us. But how do we deal with this? How do we deal with the old nature? What must we do with it? Because we can't get away from it. The only time we're going to be away from the old us is when we are with Christ. So what do we do with the old nature? Well, we have to see it as dead. We have to bury the old us. And that's the Christian experience. I have a past and I have Christ and I have a future. So I have to put the past behind me and bury the old me. That person is gone. I need to every day bury that person. So see the old you and the old nature and the old me as dead. Don't feed it. And also exercise self-control and temper the physical. Because once we feed the physical, the flesh, it will take control. So kill it off, see it as dead, don't feed it, and exercise self-control over the flesh. How do we make the new nature become stronger than the old? By living in the new, by realizing that in Christ we are made new. Live in the new us. Walk in the newness of the Spirit, in the new life that God has given to us, that we focus on spiritual godly things, that we feed the new nature by reading God's Word, by praying, by spending time with God's people. We feed this new nature and it becomes stronger in Christ. Also, that we surrender to God daily. It's not a once-off. It's not just, now that I'm a Christian, I'm going to be fine every single day. Every single day, I need to feed the spiritual and surrender to God so that the spiritual overpowers the physical flesh and the evil that I was born into. Secondly, from verse 20 to 21, we don't just see the struggle of verse 14 to 19, but we also see our sin. And verse 20 to 21 says, "Now if I do what I will not to do, it is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells in me. I find then a law, that evil is present with me, the one who wills to do good." Paul the Apostle recognizes that he cannot get away from the old sinful him, that old nature, the old Adam in us. We can't get away from it. We can't eradicate it. It will be there. And it's important for us as Christians to recognize our sinful nature. The book of 1 John chapter 1 verse 8 says, "If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us." We cannot deny sin in us. It is there. And that is what Paul is saying in these two verses, that sin is there within him. Now it's important to, as we read Romans chapter 7, that many people could accuse Paul of trying to avoid taking responsibility for his sin, but that's not what he's doing. He's just recognizing that there is something within him, and it's important so that we can take comfort from what he is saying and what God is saying, so that when we are drawn to sin and we have this real shock in sometimes how we act, that we can know that it is because there is this sin in us. But there is a danger for some to then have this attitude of saying, "Well, it's not me that's doing this. I cannot help myself." But this is not what Paul is doing at all. It is our responsibility to feed the Spirit and to not walk in the flesh, to mortify and kill off the flesh. That is our responsibility. But it doesn't mean that we don't recognize that it's there. Paul the Apostle here is acknowledging what is in him. And I want to ask you, as I ask myself, can we identify with Paul, and can we truly identify with Paul? Because we have a wrong idea of sin. Our picture of sin is sometimes warped as Christians, because Christians often think that sin is only in the physical immorality we see. And those who are not interested in coming to church, they just don't care. Those are the sinners, those adulterers and the sexually immoral and the drunkards. Those are the sinners, and also those who can't care about church. But for us in the church, we're fine. We're doing well. We're okay. But Paul is writing as an apostle here about his struggle. So we have to take notice. Because the greatest of all sin is not physical or sexual immorality or all these things of theft and covetousness and greed. That's not the worst sin. The worst sin is found in Isaiah chapter 14, which is the original sin. It's a sin that predates Adam and Eve. And that is the sin of Satan. That I will ascend above God's throne. I will be like the Most High. The original sin is pride. Satan was filled with pride. He was filled with self. And that happens within the church. That our greatest threat within our old nature might not be physical sins, but it's the sin of pride. It's the sin of self-sufficiency. It's the sin of our own ideas, own thoughts, and ruling our own lives. I want to take this reading from Galatians chapter 5, and I feel it's important for us to read this, because this is what the flesh is, and we have to recognize this within us. And it's not just physical sin, it's all sin. So Galatians 5, and I read from verse 16 to 21. So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other, so that you are not to do whatever you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. The acts of the flesh are obvious: sexual immorality, impurity and debauchery, idolatry and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions and factions, and envy, drunkenness, orgies and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. As we look at this list, it's very important because, of course, from verse 16 to 18 especially links so beautifully in to Romans chapter 7. But as we look at the acts of the flesh or the works of the flesh, it is there. And it's not just physical things. Yes, there's the first list of sexual immorality, but what about things like hatred? Jesus said, if you hate your brother, you've committed murder. Hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition. Our sin is manifested in Galatians 5, and it's every single one of us. We cannot put ourselves on a pedestal thinking that we are better than others. Paul here in Romans 7 is speaking to you, and he's speaking to me, and he's asking the same question that he asks of himself. God is asking of us, who is dominating in our lives? Is it Christ? Or is it the flesh, the old us? Because it's not just physical sin, but I want us to look deeper into emotional sin. And that's all of us. Within our marriages, within our families, within church, within our friendship circles, at work. So often, there's just this evil that sometimes comes out of us. Even when we have the best intentions at heart, but there's this other part where there's ego, we feel hurt, we feel threatened, or we feel insecure. There's so much which then births other things. So the challenge for us and the instruction for us is to daily surrender to Christ. We can never get to that place where we think we've arrived and we've made it, because sin is there. And it just takes the wrong place, the wrong time, the wrong environment for the wrong period of time. And we feed the flesh, and the flesh will overtake us. It's the same as what happens with people that have affairs. It's not about a once-off thing that just happens and you weren't aware of it. It's something that is fed over time. Most sin is birthed over a period of time. And as Christians, we must know that temptation is not the sin, but it's yielding to temptation and giving into it. So we mustn't allow our flesh to be fed and that sin to become stronger or bigger or more dominant in our lives. We have to identify sin for what it is and walk in the Spirit, and we will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. So we have our struggle and we have our sin, which is there. But then Paul brings us to a place of asking the question, now what we're going to do? It seems hopeless, but there's hope. Why? Because we have salvation. And our salvation is from verse 22 to 25. For I delight in the law of God according to the inward man. But I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members. O wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then with the mind I myself serve the law of God, but with the flesh the law of sin. In our spiritual natures as Christians, because we've been made alive to God, we delight in God. And you do and I do. We delight in the things of God. So sin sometimes is something that is not at the forefront of our thinking because we just want to be with the Lord and delight in Him, but it sometimes can overtake us, and we have to be very careful of that. But we delight in God because of this new nature that has been birthed within us, and it's God that works in us to delight in Him. God works in us, and we have now received salvation. But what is the fullness of salvation? Because here Paul is asking, who will deliver me? Because that's what salvation is. It's deliverance. Who will deliver us? But not just from one area. So what is this deliverance? The deliverance is not just about the fact that I'm going to a lost eternity, I need Christ. Who will deliver me? Not just from the spiritual, but who will deliver me from the sinful nature? And that's why I ask the question, what is the fullness of salvation? Because salvation has fullness to it. The cross of Christ was not just one thing, it was many things. So there are three things to our salvation that I want to mention that gives us security to this fullness that we can deal with the enemy within, because greater is He that's within us than he that's within the world. So God is greater in us than our sinful nature, but there is a fullness to salvation. So the first part to salvation is the fact that we are saved and delivered from the penalty of sin. And that is what justification is. That because of Christ's complete work, His death and His resurrection, we know that Jesus Christ paid the price for our sins and we are justified. We are forgiven and our debt is paid. So we are saved from the penalty of sin. Because those who are not in Christ walk in death, because there's the penalty of sin, a debt they cannot pay. Romans chapter 6 verse 23 says, for the wages of sin is death. So unless our sins are paid for, there's only one result, and that is that we have to pay for it. And the payment for that sin is our death. But because Christ has died, and He has died for us, we are in Him, He has paid the debt. We don't carry that debt. So we are saved from the penalty of sin. And the wages of sin is now not upon us because Jesus Christ paid that price. So we are saved from the penalty of sin. But then also we are saved not just from the penalty, but also from the power of sin. And that is our personal sanctification as Christians. We have received the Lord Jesus Christ, and in Him, the Holy Spirit has taken residence within our lives and He's made us alive, which is such a blessing. The Holy Spirit makes us alive. We are now spiritually alive to God, and He works in us to live godly and holy lives. But not just the fact that He works in us, He gives us the power to live these lives, as Philippians 2 verse 13 says. So not only are we saved from the penalty, but we're saved from the power. The potential within us is to live godly lives. That's the spiritual nature. And that's why Paul says here in verse 22, for I delight in the law of God according to the inward man. The inward man that has been made alive by God delights in the law, wants to live for God, wants to live a godly life. And Ephesians chapter 2 verse 1 says that we were dead, but we've been made alive. And that life is the same life as the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. It is powerful and it brings life. There is life in the believer, spiritual life, to be able to be saved from the power of sin, so that sin has no dominion or hold over us anymore, because we are not in the world anymore. We are in Christ. So we're saved from the penalty. We're saved from the power of sin. And then finally, we will one day be saved from the presence of sin, and that is glorification. Because we are still in this physical world, we are part of this bundle of life of this physical world. Sin is all around us. Because we are in this world, because we are part of the human race, because we live in a physical body, we are still bound by sin because we are in this physical body. And while we are in this world, we are not fully saved from the presence of sin, because sin is all around us. Christians, whether good Christians or not good Christians, as Christians, we are still in this world and we will be subject to things that happen in this world. Now, of course, it's part of God's sovereign plan. Whatever happens to us is part of God's will and His greater plan and purpose. Nothing happens without Him knowing about it or being in control of it. However, if someone else makes a decision, if someone else is sinful, it will impact us. It will impact our children, our families, and many other things in life, because other people are sinful and we are in this present world of sin. But the day will come in Christ, we will be delivered from the presence of sin. So in this life, we are still surrounded by sin. In our flesh, we are in this world, and therefore we are still with the sin. But in Christ, one day, when we stand before the Lord Jesus Christ, we will stand before Him and He will strip away the old us. The body then is destroyed. The flesh is destroyed, and we will stand before Him in holiness, in righteousness, in godliness that He has created within us. And that old us is gone. That there's only heaven, only what is good, only sinless perfection then in Him, in God's presence. We will then be free from sin. And that is what 1 Corinthians 15 says, when it says, "This mortal must put on immortality, and this perishable must put on the imperishable. And when the mortal has put on immortality and the perishable has put on the imperishable, then will come to pass the saying that is written, 'O death, where is your sting? O grave, where is your victory?' But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory in our Lord Jesus Christ." The day will come when all of us will be freed in Christ from this physical, sinful nature. And therefore there is salvation. That's the hope we have. So we can currently, in our physical realities, identify with what Paul is saying. We can also identify with people that are struggling, because we struggle ourselves. But we look forward to the wonderful hope that the day will come and we'll be in Christ's presence and we'll be free from sin, free from the enemy within and without, that in Christ everything will be stripped away, and will only stand before Him in the wonderful glory and the wonderful hope of eternity with Christ, where there is no sin, where He wipes away every tear, and there is no sin within His presence. That's the hope we have. So our responsibility in conclusion as Christians is to feed the spiritual nature, feed the Spirit, live in the Spirit. And it is a great challenge in our world, because we have so many things that rob us of time. It's difficult for us to redeem the time. People, you know, things take up so much of our time and our efforts, and we are bombarded by things. So we have to, as Christians, work on feeding the spiritual us. Spend time in God's Word. Spend time in prayer. Spend time with God's people. That in our week, that we balance, have balance, but that we always spend more time with godly things than we do with that of the world. And that doesn't, I'm not specifically referring to work, because we all have to work. But I'm saying sometimes the things we watch, the things we listen to, the things we read, the things we are exposed to, often there are things that this world bombards us with that is only evil. So let us spend that time with godly things and that which is good. Feed the Spirit, And we will be able to walk in the Spirit and not fulfill the lusts of the flesh. And we will be able to suppress the enemy within. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we approach your throne of grace with gratitude for the new life that we have received in you. Thank you, Lord, for the power of the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for your work in us, that you draw us to righteousness. Without you, we are nothing. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for empowering us and giving us the desire to do what is good. Thank you that we can also delight in the law in our inward man. Lord, it's a struggle. The Christian life is a struggle in this world. This is the most difficult the world has ever been because of technology and various things that bombard us with sinful thoughts and just awaken certain things in us that are not good. Help us, Lord, to just walk in the Spirit. We surrender ourselves to you. And I pray for every single person in this moment. If you are struggling with the flesh, it is difficult. We have to be empathetic toward each other's struggles. But if you are struggling and you're feeling you're losing the battle, just take this moment to surrender everything to Christ. Kill off the old you. Put it back in the grave and look up, for your redemption draweth nigh. That's where your redemption is, in Christ. Walk in the Spirit. Live in godly things and cut off all those things that are part of the old us, the old you. God will give you the strength to do that. So surrender to him now. Lord, we surrender ourselves to you. Work in us, strengthen us, and care for us. In your wonderful name we pray. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Thank you very much for joining us. I trust you were encouraged. Please join us again next week as we consider part 8 in our series. Our final hymn is a beautiful hymn, O Church, Arise. May you be blessed. Such a call.
satisfied.